Hello. It is Thursday evening, Friday morning once again, so it is time for me to do my second installment of what I've dubbed the weekly Wrapup. Talk about stuff I've picked up, stuff I've been reading, watching, listening to, and playing over the last week. So, pickups. I got a couple books from the library, and they're all manjas. They're just some manjas. I was thinking that maybe manjas would get me to read. So first I got the next two Berserks from where I'm at. I'm at 15. I started reading Berserk a little less than a year ago, spring of last year, and it's great. Once I finished the first arc, though, which is called What the People of the Golden Whatever, it was sort of like took the wind out of my sails a little bit, just a little bit. It's a pretty harrowingly apocalyptic conclusion to that storyline that just really felt bad and didn't make me want to keep going. But, you know, I've had time to stew and chew, and Mira passed away since that point. So I really would like to keep going and get to the end, you know. Oh, at least the end of what there is so far. Assuming that it is going to get finished by someone else, which is seems very likely. The other manga I picked up was the first volume of Fire Punch. Now, this got recommended to me by my friend Saul. This is a series, shorter series, and it was by the guy who is better known for his current series, Chainsaw Man. But what I know about this is what Saul told me, which I will sort of paraphrase and half remember, which is like, there are people with, like, special powers, superpowers, whatever. And so basically the main character of this is, like, a guy who can, like, heal. He's like Wolverine. He's, like, constantly healing. And I think, if I remember right, like Wolverine, it makes him, like, not age. Like, he is, like, functionally immortal. And then he gets attacked by another superhero who can, like, shoot fire, and the fire won't stop burning until, like, whatever that it's burning is, like, completely reduced to, like, ash. There's, like, no way to put the fire out. And so he gets set on fire, but since he's regenerating, he, like, can't burn out. So it just burns forever, and he's spends, like, an ungodly amount of years just, like, writhing in horrible pain, burning constantly, until he, like, figures out how to only be half on fire, as you can see in the cover. And then I think that's just sort of the setup, but that's all I know about this. Sounds fucked up and spicy and fun, and so I look forward to that. And then the only other thing I bought this week was a DVD, because I had to go to Dollar Tree to pick up a couple of little things, and they had some movies in their bin, their dollar bin, $1.25 now, and I found Vampire's Kiss, the Nicolas Cage film. Haven't seen this movie in a really long time, but I remember enjoying it a lot, so yeah, that's all I got for pickups. For reading, again, I have nothing to report. I apologize. Hopefully by next week I'll have read some of those manga and have something to talk about. For movies and television, I have been watching Curb Your Enthusiasm a little bit. Started over from the beginning. And have been enjoying that. I've been watching Nathan For You, which is also on HBO Max, and which I've never seen all of. I've just seen like clips of over the years. Wonderful show, really enjoying that. And then with two of my friends who I go over to their place and we watch stuff together and hang out pretty often. We've been watching Twin Peaks. I talked about that last week. Well, we finished Twin Peaks this week. That was really wonderful, getting to rewatch that. I hadn't in a while. I hadn't rewatched the show since the third season aired almost 5 years ago, which is a very long time for me to have gone without watching that show. I've seen the original two seasons probably more than 10, but less than 20 times. That would be my estimation, somewhere between 10 and 20 times. Probably like 15 to 20 times. And I've seen the movie about that many times as well. But I'd only seen The Return once. And it's so lovely. It's such a lovely thing. I have so much love for it. It makes me feel so exhilarated and alive. It's like a beautiful puzzle, and every time I watch it, it just sort of like clicks a little more sharply into focus, and I love that about it. And it was really fascinating getting to rewatch it, knowing where it was going to end up, and catch all sorts of stuff that I missed the first time through. Maybe someday I'll talk more in depth about Twin Peaks, but for now, just suffice it to say that it is, you know, one of my favorite things to ever exist, one of my favorite stories that's ever been told. Totally beautiful, mind-boggling, the best television that's ever been made. And the movie is one of my favorite movies of all time. Just truly impeccable and incredible. The other things I watched this week were from two... So with those friends, I have also been watching a few other shows, though less intensely. So we've been watching Station 11, which they have seen and I haven't, but I read the book, and we are about halfway through that. I believe we watched episode 5 yesterday when I was with them, which takes us to the halfway point. And I'm enjoying that. It's good. I would probably like it more if I hadn't read the book. There's nothing wrong with it. It's not a bad adaptation by any stretch of the imagination. It's more just like all of the interesting like ways that the story goes, the non-linear, the weaving narrative, the different characters and how they wind up becoming connected to each other. I know all of that already, so it isn't really like impressing me with the way that it sort of juggles all that stuff, just because the book already did that, you know. I do think it's really well made, and very good piece of television, and I recommend it, even though I haven't seen all of it yet. The other shows that we were watching together, we haven't watched any of in the last week because we were watching those. And so then last week on Friday, I hung out with a friend of mine, and we watched movies all night. And first he wanted to watch At Eternity's Gate, which I had not seen, and he had not either. And that is the film that Julian Schnabel made just a couple years ago, starring Willem Dafoe, about Vincent van Gogh. And it is, you know, on paper, I suppose, a biopic about the last couple years of his life, but it also posits this, you know, controversial and largely, like, unprovable theory that some art historians have, that his death was not a suicide, that there was, like, some sort of involvement of other people. In the film, it's portrayed that he is accidentally struck by a bullet by two kids who are, like, horsing around with a gun. That's not particularly important to the story, though, which I found to be interesting that they included that when it didn't really have that much bearing, or in the sense that, like, reframing his death away from a suicide kind of made, I guess it does support more the themes that the story is trying to work out. And so the style of this film, I've only the only other schnobble of schnobble's movies that I've seen, because he's a visual artist, and started as a visual artist for many years before he started making film, is The Diving Bell and the Butterfly, which I saw back when it came out 15 years ago, and I really liked a lot, and I have not watched it since then. I think I saw it probably more than once around that time, but it's been over 10 years since I've seen it, and I need to see it again. I remember, though, how striking the camera in that movie is, and I really felt the same way here. It's an incredible, incredible camera. Just the cinematography is just unbelievable. I can't think of anybody whose use of the camera feels more intimate and emotional that is working right now than Julian Schnabel. And this movie really plays into that. A lot of what this movie is about having the character of Van Gogh talk about art, talk about his philosophies about art, and then having those ideas be recursive and flow back into the film itself, and sort of live by the rules that he is laying out, which is a really cool way to make the movie. The result, like Van Gogh's art, you know, isn't, you know, particularly narrative in its a lot of images of ordinary things, but it's done in this very evocative way. So it's not a particularly narrative movie, which I think is going to turn a lot of people off. I think it kind of turned my friend off a little bit. I think he was looking for, like, a movie about Van Gogh with Willem Dafoe, you know, just in a sort of maybe more traditional biopic sense. I don't really like traditional biopics that much. I thought this was much better than what you usually get from a biopic. And great, incredible performance from Willem Dafoe, but that doesn't even need to be said. He's probably the greatest living actor working in the English language. And really good supporting performances from Oscar Isaac and from Mads Mikkelsen and many others. There was a little bit of a sort of, I felt I couldn't fully emotionally connect with the film all the way. It was very stunning and beautiful, but it didn't really resonate with me on, like, a deeper level. So I would give it, like, a 9, just on pure technical mastery, incredible, beautiful, spectacular, but there was something in its heart and its core that just wasn't quite there for me that held it back a little bit. After that, he said that I should pick a movie. I ended up picking something that I had already seen. He said, because he knows that I go over to my two friends, Ellie and Ridley, who I go and see watch movies with a lot, he was like, pick something that you wouldn't watch with them because they would probably not like it. So there, I could have taken this in a lot of directions. The direction I ended up, at first I was thinking about watching Antichrist, but it wasn't available on any of the, he only had, like, Amazon to do rentals, because of we were doing it through, like, his cable box, I don't know. It wasn't on Amazon, and I couldn't put Criterion Channel on his thing so that I could pull it up and watch it there, so we couldn't watch that. So I ended up renting, one of my favorite films, Brawl in Cell Block 99, which came out in 2017, directed by S. Craig Zahler, starring Vince Vaughn. Zahler is a guy who has made a big splash in the last 5 years. He made his first film, Bone Tomahawk, and then shortly after he made this one, Brawl in Cell Block 99, and then just shortly after that, he made a third directorial feature, Dragged Across Concrete. He's doing something that I think is easy to compare to Tarantino, but is very different than Tarantino. And so the way it's easy to compare to Tarantino is that he's clearly coming from a background of influence from exploitation cinema, genre cinema, grindhouse cinema, all of that. But he is sort of taking the tropes, the themes, the ideas from those films, and instead making these sort of like very long prestige dramas out of them, right? But where Tarantino movies are like, they are both also dialogue heavy, very dialogue heavy. Tarantino, he always, to me, feels more sort of about embracing the sort of fun and spectacular aspects of those films. His films often feel very humorous, often very exciting, and fun. Even though they are long, you know, they don't feel long, right? They feel fun. They feel snappy. Even the 4-hour, you know, version of Hateful Eight feels pretty, you know, it moves along, you know, it moves at a good pace. Zoller makes slow burn movies. They tread very slowly. They move very methodically. They are dialogue heavy, but his dialogue is very literary in the sense that it doesn't really sound like how people actually talk. It's not realistic dialogue, but it is very like verbose, and I like that. It's very cool. It gives the whole world of his films this sort of like removal from reality that I find really appealing. And he all of his movies generally, you know, it's all about like taking a lot of time to build characters and set things up and put all the pieces in place before the game really starts, you know, like a good chunk of time into the movie. So this movie and his first film, Bone Tomahawk, are both like 2 hours and 15 minutes. And then his third film, Dragged Across Concrete, is like 2 hours and 40, 45 minutes. So he makes long movies. And he's usually like at least the halfway point, if not further into the movie, before like shit really starts happening. And this film is no exception. The brief sort of synopsis of this film, I will give away basically, I think, as much as you can assume from the title, Brawl in Cell Block 99. Basically, Vince Vaughn plays this guy Bradley, who is a recovering alcoholic. He has a wife who is also in recovery. Their relationship is tense. They tried to have a child, but she had a miscarriage, and it's been very hard on them. Their lives are not going well. And so he decides that to build a better life for them and to try and have a child and build a better life for their child, he's going to start running drugs for a old friend of his, even though he had sworn he wasn't going to do this. Well, he does, you know, build a better life, but then, of course, the house of cards comes sort of tumbling down. He winds up in prison. And as part of how he wound up in prison, some of the people who were a sort of rival gang who he was working with also went to prison. And so they are holding him responsible for this. And so, while he is in prison, he is basically contacted and told that there is something bad that is going to happen unless he does something, which is get himself transferred to a different prison, a high security prison. He's in a medium security prison. And then when he gets to that prison, he has to get to cell block 99 and find this specific person, and he has to murder that man. And if he doesn't, a bad thing will happen. So Vince Vaughn is like unrecognizable in this film. He's extremely good. He's in Dragged Across Concrete as well. He's extremely good in that as well. I have these two movies totally won me over for Vince Vaughn is capable of doing really good work. I don't know if I like Vince Vaughn necessarily. I don't like him as a person, but like he's got the chops, that's for sure. Zoller rubs a lot of people the wrong way because he works with Hollywood conservatives a lot. His first film, Bone Tomahawk, stars Kurt Russell. This one's got Vince Vaughn. And then the third one has Vince Vaughn again, as well as Mel Gibson. Now, you know, I don't like any of those guys on a personal level. And Mel Gibson is a pretty abjectly terrible person. You know, we've got the receipts, you know, to know that he is virulently racist and anti-Semitic, amongst other things. And working with Mel Gibson is not great. But I still really like that movie. I think it's my least favorite of the three, Dragged Across Concrete, but it's still very, very good. Very, 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 very good. And so, also, his characters, I think, do embody a lot of things, not only working with people that are objectionable, or maybe, you know, that people on the left side of the spectrum would disagree with, but the characters in the films often are not... are of the right wing as well, I would say. Bone Tomahawk is a period piece, so that's kind of, you know, can't really count that. But, like, Bradley, in this film, he's, you know, a working-class, blue-collar kind of guy, patriotic. He has flags hanging over his door. There's conversations about that. You know, he believes in liberty in a sort of libertarian sense. And he is very dedicated to the nuclear family, to, you know, masculinity, all of these traditional values. The thing, though, I don't know, because I don't know much about Zoller in general. I've never really read interviews with him or anything like that. So I don't know how much of this is, like, him parroting his own beliefs. But the way I read Cell Block 99 is not as a celebration of these facts. If anything, it feels like the opposite. It feels like all of those things that Bradley is so strongly adhering to, the things, these principles, these American capitalistic patriarchal systems that he believes in, that he is doing everything he can to support, it's like a death cult for him. It is the thing that is driving him to oblivion. Maybe it's just me. Maybe that's just my Marxist-Leninist, you know, goggles looking at this movie, and seeing things that aren't necessarily intentionally there. But that's the way I read that. That's the way that I read Dragged Across Concrete as well, which is a story about two crooked cops who try and rob bank robbers. Anyways, I love Zoller. I love this film. This film fucking rules. The violence in this movie is like, it's so fucking harsh. It's so explosively violent. And the violence, it's so raw and gory, but also very brief, and it goes from 0 to 100 instantaneously, and it will go long periods of time with nothing happening, and then something unbelievably fucked up will happen, just out of nowhere. And it's incredible. I love that. And on all of his films feel that way, too. They feel, like, explosively violent. And I love that about him a lot. I really just could gush about Zoller for days, and this might be my favorite of his three movies, so, yeah. Then after that, we watched one more movie. We had been talking about watching Uncut Gems, because he hasn't seen it, and I haven't seen it in a while, and we both really like Daniel Lopatin, 10 Tricks Point Never, who did the soundtrack for it. But then we were talking, and neither of us had seen Good Time, the Safdie brothers' first film, or not first film, but previous film, which also had a soundtrack by 10 Tricks Point Never. So we watched that instead, because neither of us had seen it. So Good Time, incredible. Incredible, incredible, incredible. Maybe not quite as incredible as Uncut Gems. I would still give both of them like a 10, but just marginally not quite as good. And brief plot synopsis without giving anything away, really. I'll only give away stuff that happens in the first 5 to 10 minutes of the movie. Robert Pattinson stars as Connie Constantine, who is just sort of like the biggest piece of shit of all time. And he has a brother who is played by Benny Safdie, one of the directors of the film, who is developmentally disabled. And at the beginning of the film, his brother is in like care, in inpatient care type of situation. Connie comes, he takes him out of it, he says, "You don't need that, all you need is me, I'll take care of you, these people don't love you, I love you." And then he ropes his brother in to help him rob a bank. And it doesn't go well, and Connie gets away, but his brother does not. And so basically the rest of the movie is about Connie trying to find money so that he can bail his brother out of jail. And it all takes place over the course of one night. A lot of people compare this to After Hours, the Martin Scorsese film. I think it's a fair comparison because it too is like it's a New York movie. It all takes place over the course of one night. This person is going on this sort of quixotic journey into the nightlife of New York, and it's sort of like a series of events that all kind of flow one into the next. So in that sense, I do think it is comparable to After Hours. After Hours is also a sort of like Kafka-esque nightmare where like nothing ever goes right, and it's just like everything is constantly going, the worst possible outcome is happening. But After Hours is a comedy. It's always played as like for laughs, played as a dark comedy. Good Times is not the quirked up white boy busting it down sexual style that After Hours is. It is just tense, unpleasant, not fun, upsetting, nothing really good ever happens in it. In that way, it is very similar to Uncut Gems. However, the things that separate the, you know, everything just keeps getting worse and worse. The big difference is that in this movie, Connie, the main character, sucks. He's a piece of shit. You're never on his side. You never want him to succeed. Because if he succeeds, he's just going to keep exploiting his disabled brother. You know? Like, that's the good outcome in his mind. So I'm never rooting for him. And when bad things happen to him, I'm like, good, fuck this guy. I'm glad bad things happen to him. And then the Uncut Gems, I feel the inverse, you know? Like, Howie's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but he is a sympathetic character. You understand him. You empathize for him. I empathize for him. I understand what it's like to be consumed by like addiction and things that are out that you can't control yourself, and it's like you're just clawing to try and hold on to the fucking cliff, and you just can't, and you just keep slipping and slipping and slipping, and that's an awful feeling. And Uncut Gems does an incredible job of capturing that feeling. And in that movie, when all of the bad things are happening, it's making you feel bad. It's making you feel so bad for him. And that's why I think Uncut Gems is a more successful film, because it's creating a more evocative response from the audience than Good Time is. Good Time is shorter. It's more concise. It's, I don't know. There are things about it that are better. I think it might be more fun and enjoyable than Uncut Gems, because you don't have that connection to the main character, to the protagonist, that it causes you all this pain. But still, I don't know. So that was Friday night. And then the other night that I watched movies was last night. Again, with my friends Ellie and Ridley. I brought over a stack of movies of some of my favorites. And the one that they picked out to watch was one that neither of them had seen before, which was Heat, starring Robert De Niro and Al Pacino, alongside so many other people. Maybe the best cast of a movie ever made. And so Heat is like a comfort movie for me. I just love Heat so much. I can throw it on anytime and just enjoy myself. I don't have to pay super close attention to it because I've seen it so many times. And you know, I can kind of just sort of like be in and out, and then, you know, the bank robbery happens, and then I'm like, eh, and then, you know, it's not like that's the only fun thing that happens in the whole movie, but that is, of course, the highlight. And so Heat is a cat and mouse heist movie about a thief, a bank robber played by Robert De Niro, who leads a crew, and then Al Pacino plays a robbery homicide detective who is trying to track him down and capture him. And there's like a ticking clock element as they get closer to each other. The centerpiece of the movie is a bank robbery scene. It's probably the greatest action scene ever committed to film. The way that I sort of sold this movie to these two people who don't have a particular huge interest in like a super masculine action movie is I was like, in my, like, it's a, I, my headcanon for this movie is that it's very gay. I think it's a very gay movie. I don't think that Michael Mann intended for this, but I think it's very hard not to see it that way if you think about it. You know, these two men who are, the whole sort of idea behind the movie is that they are sort of opposite sides of the same coin, right? The crux of the film is the scene where they meet and they have coffee. And they talk, and it's like, you know, the resolution that they reach is, it's like, I have to do the thing that I'm the best at doing, which is robbing banks, and you have to do the thing that you're the best at, which is trying to stop guys like me. And, you know, there's nothing, I don't know how to do anything except this, and you don't know how to do anything except that. And, like, both of them have, you know, terrible personal lives. They're not able to have, you know, emotional connections or fulfilling relationships with other people because they're so consumed by the things that they do. It's the only thing that gives them any purpose, even though maybe there isn't really any purpose to those things that they do. It's just like, the more that they're opposite, the more that they are just the same. They're just mirrors of each other. And they, you can tell that they have this incredible amount of respect for one another, and it's culminated in that scene where, you know, Al Pacino says, you know, now that I've met you and I've seen you face to face, if I have to kill you, I'm not going to be happy about it. And De Niro says, like, I feel the same way, but I'm not going to hesitate to do so because, you know, I'm not going to let anybody stop me, including you. It feels very two men who are terminally on a path of collision with each other. And in a different context, it sounds like, you know, a true romance story, right? And then at the end of the film, they share a moment of true intimacy, physical intimacy. I don't know. I know it's just my headcanon. It's not, you know, it's not really there. But I think it's very easy to read it that way. And I think it makes the movie a lot more interesting, too, because the movie is so much, like Brawl in Cellblock 99, about masculinity, about patriarchy, about, you know, providing for your family, all these things, and like, it's about all of these guys. All of the characters in this film are all trying to do what they think is the right thing in their own way, you know? Even with the people who are robbing, all of them except for De Niro, they have families, they have children. They're trying to provide, they're trying to make those relationships work as best they can. Pacino's doing the same thing, you know, but all of them seems like they are just incapable of ever actually doing what is right. You know, there is something about the systems that they operate within that keeps them at arm's reach from achieving the goals that they actually want to achieve. It feels to me like a condemnation of those systems. Maybe I'm just reading too much into it, but that's the way that I look at Heat. Then after that, they were like, okay, well, Ellie was like, I'll pick a movie off of my list. She's got this long list of movies that she likes that I haven't seen. And so she read them out, and one of them was Ocean's 8. And I was like, Ocean's 8, it's a heist movie. It's a lady heist movie. Heat's kind of, it's not exclusively men in the movie, but, you know, besides Ashley Judd, it pretty much is. I was like, perfect, you know, we got man heist, now we can have lady heist. So we watched Ocean's 8. I have only seen the first of the Ocean's movies, and I haven't seen it since it came out. And I was in grade school when it came. I believe I was in my sixth grade, which is my last year of grade school. And I never saw the sequels. Apparently Danny Ocean is dead. That's how this one opens, with Danny Ocean being dead. Whatever. I would like to rewatch that and see the other two as well, because I believe Soderbergh is a very good director, and I should watch those. I just never did. Ocean's 8 is fine. It is perfectly fine. I have nothing super positive or negative to say about it. It does everything very adequately. It never really does anything flashy or interesting, but it never really biffs it either. Pretty incredible cast list. Nobody really blowing my mind here. Part of the problem when you've got a, you know, 100-minute movie with 8 leads, nobody really gets time to shine, except because nobody has like more than 5 to 10 minutes of screen time, except for Sandra Bullock. And Sandra Bullock is kind of whatever, in my opinion. She's got her movies that I like, but she herself is never really the thing that I'm there for, as much as I love Speed. So this movie's fine. This is a totally fine and acceptable film. I would have given it a 7, except for the presence of James Corden. James Corden shows up in the third act of this movie. He's not in it a ton. He's maybe in it for 5 minutes, but any amount of James Corden is enough to automate a 1-point deduction from the score of a film. Unfortunately, I don't make the rules. That's just the way it is. Unfortunately, you know, James Corden, and you know, the more James Corden is in it, of course, the more the score will be affected. But any amount of James Corden at all is going to negatively impact the score of the film. So I have to lower the score. I would give Ocean's 8 to a 6. So if you like heist movies, if you like those kinds of things, I think it's perfectly acceptable. It's fun. You don't need to think about it too much. It is pretty gay. I like that too. I like that it had a lot of big lesbian energy in the movie. Cate Blanchett, particularly, huge lesbian energy in this movie, which was cool. I like that. I would like to see more of that in movies in general, you know. And I liked that, you know, it's I hate this, the backlash against stuff like this, or against like Lady Ghostbusters, where they're like, oh well, they're not supposed to be ladies, or like, oh, we're just making it again but with ladies, or like, why does it have to be all ladies? who get blah blah blah, all of that criticism sucks. Like, I think that having more movies that are like female centric, starring all women, I think that's great. I think that, you know, we should be able to have ensemble women films. Like, why not? I love that idea. I just want them to be good movies, you know. And this and Ghostbusters 2016, they're not bad, but they're not great either. And so, like, I understand the appeal for a lot, for women to, especially, to, you know, be like, I want to support this because it's got all these women in it, and et cetera, et cetera. But I just wish that they were good movies. I also wish that they were made by women. That would be extra cool, because this movie wasn't, and Ghostbusters wasn't. And there's just, like, so few... It's so hard for women directors. They don't get work. There are so few of them. The representation for women as directors is staggeringly low. And I'm guilty too. And when you look at the canon, you know, film canon, there's so few women and so few female directed movies that, like, get seriously talked about as, like, among the greatest, you know. And in the English language, it's, like, abysmal. It's terrible. Like, I mean, female directors who make movies in the English language. Jane Campion, she made the Piano, and others. She was the first woman to win the Palm at the Cannes Film Festival. And then, like, Catherine Bigelow, who was the first Oscar Best Director winner, but, you know, for The Hurt Locker, a movie that I thought was really bad. And she's made good movies, but, like... And, like, after that, like... How, like... We've got Greta Gerwig and Lena Dunham and... Who else is, like, really, like, notable? Like... At least somewhat household name level. It's not a ton, and that sucks. So, I would like to see more of that. So that was it for movies. Then, for games, I had some good gaming times. So on Sunday, I got invited by a friend of mine from college who I play games with quite a bit, Saul. I mentioned him earlier because he's the guy who recommended Fire Punch to me. He invited me to come play games with a couple of people that we went to college with who I hadn't seen in, like, since I finished college, like, 7 years ago. And that was really nice. It was really lovely to get to see those two friends of mine who I hadn't gotten to see in a really long time. Got to chat and see how we were doing, and it was really good. It was really nice. We played a couple games. First, we played a game that Saul brought that he was really excited about playing called Chinatown. Now, I will say, this is a game that was published in the mid-2000s, which was when it was still kind of a little Wild West-y for what you could have be the theme of your board game. This is similar to what I touched on last week when I talked about playing the Tales of the Arabian Nights game. So there is some static with me with this game because the theme feels kind of gross. And there's nothing about the game that, like, it needs to be, like, you're an Chinese immigrant, you know, that is selling dim sum or whatever. Like, I don't know, it feels iffy. But I will say that the Asian person who played the game won, and she declared, you know, at least the Asian person won, you know, all is right in that respect. Which I thought was very funny. But basically, it's a game where you're in New York City, you're all trying to establish businesses in Chinatown, and so it's a very interactive game. Basically, you will all sort of draft random building spaces on the board, and then you will all draft random shop tiles, and each different kind of shop requires a certain number of spaces that are connected on the board to have the same tile on it in order for them to function fully. And then at the end of every round, you'll get money based on all of your shops. And so basically, once everybody gets all their stuff drafted, then you just make deals with other people. You make deals for their spaces, you make deals for their shop tiles. You have money to sweeten the pot or whatever. And you play over like 5 rounds, and then at the end of the 5th round, whoever has the most money is the winner. I really enjoyed the game a lot. I thought it was a really fun time. Most games that are really popular and good don't have a lot of player interaction like that, which is too bad, because I like player interaction a lot of the time. I really like player interaction. And, making a deal, doing sort of psychology stuff and politicking the table and things like that is really fun. I really enjoy that aspect of gaming a lot, and this game really delivered on that, so I really enjoyed my time with Chinatown quite a bit. The second game we played a ton of times, and that is The Crew, The Quest for Planet 9. I have my copy of this here, but as you can see, it is brand new, unused. I bought this maybe 6 months ago. It's a cheap game, it's only $15, but I have not gotten a chance to play it yet. I've brought it to a couple game nights, and it has been passed over for other things. They had a copy, and so we played with their copy, and this is fucking incredible. I'd heard nothing but incredible things about it, and they were all true. So this is a trick-taking game, if you're familiar with that concept, games like Hearts or Spades, where, there are different suits, or colors in this case, and then one person starts the game off by playing one card, and then every other player must in turn play a card from the same suit or color if they can, and then whoever has the highest number of that trick will win the trick and take it. And then in this game, the trump cards take the form of rockets. There are 4 rockets that each have a number 1 through 4 on them. But this is a cooperative trick-taking game. And so what that means is that there is actually a campaign. The campaign, it has some story. Not super important story. But each game, you have a sort of mission. And the mission is like, you will have to complete a certain number of objectives. And the objectives are these little cards, and so they will look like this, And so this is the blue one. So basically what it'll be is that someone will get dealt, each number of players will get dealt different objectives. And so if I have the blue one, that means that I have to win a trick that has the blue one in it. And if all of the objectives get met, then we win. Sounds pretty simple, right? I didn't mention something extremely important, which is that you are not allowed to speak or do any sort of physical movement that would indicate a communication of any kind during the game. The only way you can communicate is by doing a single communication action, which is not even always available to you, where you basically get to lay down one card from your hand to reveal it, and then you can place a token on it, which will indicate to everyone either that this is your highest card of this suit, your lowest card of this suit, or your only card of this suit. That is the only amount of communication that is allowed to be made during the entire game. Everything else is entirely based on people trying to solve the puzzle without having all of the pieces together. It's an incredible game. It's an extremely complex thing. And so they were already a decent way into the game when we were playing. We didn't start over from the beginning because I'm not a little bitch. So we started on mission 18, which required us to have 5 objectives that we had to complete. And now that I'm looking at the rules here, I think so we actually did start on 19, not 20. So we had to have 5 tricks, or 5 goals. 1 goal, whoever the captain was, the leader, which gets determined randomly, they had to choose one of the goals to be the first one that we solve, meaning that, like, we can't accomplish any of the other ones until that first one is taken care of. And we couldn't communicate until after we had done 2 tricks. So the first 2 rounds, when we're going after that first goal, at the very least, we can't tell anyone anything about anything. And it took us 15 tries, maybe? Now, I say that most of those tries lasted a couple minutes, because we would play 1, 2, 3 hands and whiff and lose immediately. Which sounds frustrating, and it is a little bit, but since it's cooperative and we're all working together, it doesn't feel, you know, insurmountable. It's more like, we gotta rally, we can do this, we're gonna fuck this game up, we're gonna fuck this shit up, we're gonna do it, and then when you do, it's like, yeah, like, ah, big serotonin, so much fun, so incredible. I really can't wait to play this game more with people. I just think this is just a genius design, and it's $15. So cheap. So one of the cheapest board games you can buy. Incredible. So good. Then after that, the 2 people whose house Saul and I were at, our friends, they both had stuff they had to do. But Saul and I didn't, and Saul was like, "Do you want to come over to my house and keep playing board games?" And I was like, "Yeah, of course." So, we went to Saul's house, and we played a couple of games that I had that he hadn't played, and then a couple games that he had that I hadn't played. The first thing we played was one of his games, which is called Furnace. This is a pretty recent game, came out last year, and it's a really cool little game where it's an engine-building game, where basically there is a sort of row of cards that gets dealt out. Each card, you are all like capitalists in the Industrial Revolution trying to make as much money as possible, basically. And each card is like will be a piece in your engine. You have a number of different resources that you can gain, and then money, and then whoever has the most money at the end of the game wins. And so every round you bid on cards in the row, and then whoever wins the bids will get the card, but the losers will get, like, a payout bonus for losing in the form of resources, and then you choose where in your line of cards you put them, and once they're in the line, that's it, they're locked in, and then after that you go one card at a time down your list, taking whatever actions you can or choose to, hoping that you can optimize, you know, your engine and have the most stuff at the end. Super crunchy, lovely little puzzle of trying to, you know, put everything in the right order and think 5 steps ahead so that you can figure out how to maximize, you know, what you're making and then what you can turn those things into. Lovely. And there is a little bit of player interaction because of the bidding part and stuff like that. So that's really cool. I really liked this game a lot. I thought it totally rocked my socks off. It has a very boring theme, but I really loved the mechanics of it a lot. Then we played Terraforming Mars, which I have here. And this is one of my favorite games of all time. I have like 3 different expansions crammed into this box that are varyingly good. But we just played with the base stuff. Terraforming Mars is also a game about being a hyper-capitalist. You all play as competing, corporations who are working to terraform Mars, and you're in competition with one another, and the sort of goal of the game is to be the biggest contributor to the terraforming. And so you can gain points from increasing the level of oxygen, increasing the temperature of the surface of the planet, or from creating oceans, creating water on the surface. And this is also an engine-building game. There are a number of different resources, and then you have cards that cost money, that you get a income every turn, and you spend the money to play the cards, and then the cards can like increase your production, or it can decrease one production to increase another production, or it can decrease another person's production, or you can steal resources that person has produced, or you can play a card that can let you trade one production for another, once per turn, etc., etc., and you just kind of keep ramping and snowballing this big behemoth of things forward until you reach a point where the game ends, which is when the planet is terraformed to the point where it is habitable. All of the three terraforming tracks reach their maximum, and then the game ends. It is just such a satisfying little game, and it doesn't have very much player interaction, but it is extremely... It really, like, tickles my brain in all the right ways, and I love that about it. And Saul had a good time playing it, too. Then, I talked about this last week, but now I played it with another person, Railroad Inc., Blazing Red Edition. I played this with Saul. We played a game of it. It was really fun. Playing it with another person versus playing it by yourself functionally has no difference. Because there is literally zero interaction between people in this game. But then at the end, it's literally just like you all play the game by yourself at the same time, and whoever does the best is the winner. That's fine. But it's quick, it's a half hour maybe to play this game. And it's very enjoyable. I enjoyed it quite a bit. And then we played a game that I had never played called Fugitive. This is a two-player hidden movement game. And we played it a couple times. We played it a bunch of times having the rules wrong and having it be, like, way too hard for the fugitive. But once we figured out that we were playing it wrong, then we started playing it again and kind of figured it out, and it became much more enjoyable. But basically, it's just that, like, there are decks of cards that all have numbers on them from, like, 1 to 42. And, the fugitive starts with the cards 1, 2, 3, and 42. And basically every turn you're putting a card down face, at least one card down face down, generally. And some cards, they have to be within a certain distance of each other from the last one. But then playing additional cards can help you move further between. And then that's the fugitive's turn. And then on the agent's turn, secret agent's turn, they draw a card, so they learn one card that's not on the board, and then they guess a card. And if the card is correct, then that gets flipped over. And the goal is to try and get all the cards flipped over, and then the goal for the fugitive is to play the 42 card. And if you do play the 42 card, then the agent has one chance to guess every single card on the board. And if they do, they win, and if they fail, then the fugitive wins. It's pretty straightforward, enjoyable, fun, trying to, tricky the other player, trying to throw them off, and that's really cool. And then the other side is, like, trying to work out. It's like Clue on four dimensions, very satisfying. And then finally, to end off the night, we played Seven Wonders Duel, which both of us have played many, many, many times, but never together. And then also he has the expansion for it, which I had never played, the Pantheon expansion, which was really cool. It didn't add a ton to the game. I didn't think it really changed the game that much, but that's okay. It was interesting. It added a little bit, and that's kind of maybe the best way for an expansion to be. Had a great time doing that. And other than... Fugitive, I beat Saul at everything. So there you go. Suck it, Saul. So that was my gaming for the week. And then just really briefly, I will say that I did start playing a video game. I started playing Lisa, The Painful. This is a PC game that came out a number of years ago. I have started it a couple times and then kind of gotten stuck and not known what to do, so I'm playing it with a walkthrough now because I'm not opposed to that. And I'm really enjoying myself. I played an hour of it earlier today. I will have more to say about that when I finish it, I assume. All right, for music, I had to reshoot this section because it didn't occur to me when I shot it, but it occurred to me when I was editing it that the numbers were wrong. And so I figured it out. The thing is, I left Spotify this week. I know there's been an exodus of people leaving because of the Joe Rogan stuff, and that didn't help, but it was something I'd been wanting to do for a while, just because of Spotify's business practices. I find to be extraordinarily unethical. The amount of money that artists make is obscene, and you know, all streaming services have that problem, but other ones pay a little bit more and maybe don't invest their money in weapons manufacturing or things like that. And now, as artists are leaving Spotify, you know, they're available other places. It's just, you know, it was time to go. So I went for Tidal. Certainly has problems with the service. I don't think, you know, the user experience on Tidal is nearly as good as it is on Spotify, which is too bad, but it's a sacrifice that I'm willing to make. But I figured out that my phone wasn't scrabbling. I had linked my Last.fm account to Tidal on my computer in the desktop application, but apparently they got rid of scrabbling on Android. It's just not in the application anymore for some reason, which is extremely stupid and weird. Why do you have it on PC but you don't have it on Android? I think I've got that remedied now. I got a third-party scrabbler that I got set up on my phone, and then I had to go in and kind of custom scrabble everything that I had listened to on my phone over the last 5 or 6 days from memory, some of which I remembered pretty well. The stuff that I had been listening to the most, though, I kind of had to ballpark it. It's imperfect, but this is much more accurate to what I've actually listened to in the last, you know, week. So here are the top five, you know, now. Fifth place, we have REM, one of my favorite bands of my adolescence. Fantastic band. This was just, I listened to their album Life Search Pageant, which is probably my favorite of their albums. It's their fourth album, came out in the 80s. Just such a good band, such a great string of records. Everything they did from their debut up through Automatic for the People in 94, was that 93? Is incredible. Just great. Every single record, the first, that would have been eight records, all really good records. Variance in quality to a degree, but all of them great. And that one is maybe my favorite. On the outside, underneath the wall, all the money couldn't place, we have Pavement. Pavement, one of the biggest, most important, most beloved indie rock bands of the 90s. This was exclusively me earlier tonight out driving, delivering. I listened to Slanted and Enchanted, their first record, and then I listened to the first, like, third or quarter, first few songs of their third album, Wowie Zowie, before I went home and quit listening to music. I love Pavement. I have loved Pavement for many, many, many years. They're a sort of perennial band for me that I just sort of always listen to on a pretty regular basis. They're gonna be playing here on a reunion tour this year. They had their first reunion tour in like 2010, and I didn't go because I couldn't afford it. And I really want to go this time. I am again worried I'm not gonna be able to afford it, but we will see. We will see.
Treat it like an oil well. When it's underground, out of sight. And if the sight is just a horse sign, can it make enough sense to me? Pretend the table is a trust knot. We'll put our labels down, pages down. I'll watch them yarn and twine unravel, and you never get it back. It's what I want.
It's what I want.
It's what I want.
Twine comes down.
It's what I want.
It's what I want.
Don't you know I could make it try, make it try, make it try, make it try.
Second place, I have Deerhoof. Another band that I have loved for a bajillion years and is a sort of perennial favorite and I listen to quite a bit. This was just, I listened to their album Milkman a couple times, which is maybe my favorite of their albums. It was the first one I heard. I heard it when it came out when I was in ninth grade. And it totally warped my brain. It was one of the first, like, truly, like, experimental or weird things that I ever heard. Truly weird. You know, not like Frank Zappa weird. Just incredible blends of avant-garde and indie rock and all sorts of genres. I love Deerhoof. They are just a impeccable band that have been around for 25 years, and they've put out like 18 LPs or something, and they're all good. Like, you can always count on a Deerhoof record, it's gonna be good every time. Very few bands can say that. Two and number one are the same as they were last week. Number two, William Bonney. Number one, Foxtails. So yeah, I've been pretty in my screamo era for the last couple weeks, which is cool. I've been having a really good time listening to Midwest Screamo and jamming out in the car. Definitely, like, really jamming out to No Pizza by William Bonney, and that's like my jam right now. My big jam right now is No Pizza by William Bonney. Good week for music, but I had some hiccups along the way. I'm excited about Tidal. No, I'm not excited about Tidal. I'm happy that I'm not using Spotify anymore. That's what it is. I'm not excited about Tidal. Of course, the best way to support musicians is to buy their records, physical copies of the albums, buy their merch, buy tickets to their concerts. That is how bands make money. Bands aren't making money from streaming. Very, very, very few bands are making money from streaming. So, you know, on Spotify, the artist payout is about a third of a cent for every stream. And then, you know, at least half of that is getting taken by the label, generally speaking. And then you've got to pay, you know, managers or whatever, whoever you owe, you know, royalties to. And then whatever is left after that is going to get divided up amongst all of the members of the band. You know? So, like, Max Collins of Eve 6, who's been a big vocal proponent of you know, the exodus from Spotify, he's talking about how, like, you know, Eve 6 gets, like, 1.3 million streams a month. Of course, the majority of those streams are for the early Eve 6 stuff, when they, you know, when Heart in a Blender was a thing, that song and the few other smaller hits that they had. And all of that stuff is, the masters aren't owned by the band, they're owned by the label, so the label is taking almost all the money from it. And so, like, the total monthly income that Eve 6 receives for 1.3 million streams on Spotify is like $5,000 split between all four members of the band, you know? And most people are not getting a million streams a month. Most people are not getting a million streams a month. Eve 6 certainly not the biggest band in the world. You know, most people would call them a one-hit wonder. Maybe not quite, but, you know, they haven't had a big song in 20 years, and it's just not great. It's just it's a really bad system, and basically what it is that, like, the Spotify made, you know, deals behind closed doors that we don't really know what they were, where the record labels basically allow them to pay extremely low royalties per song, and in exchange, the record labels are able to invest in Spotify as a public company, and so they're basically just paying themselves, you know, in valuation in the company. And then the artists get, you know, a pittance. It's very sad. So the Joe Rogan stuff sucks, but that's not, I don't care about that. And the audio quality stuff sucks, but I don't care about that either. You know, I think that Neil Young really showed his hand when he made the big fuss about everything and then left Spotify and then started running sponsored content on his social medias promoting Amazon Music instead as like a better alternative. Like, hey, my music's on Amazon Music and they have higher quality streaming, so sign up now and use promo code Neil Young and I'll give you 1 month free on Amazon Music. You know, it's like, that's not the answer. I don't want to leave one Globocorp of evil for another one. It's not, you know, there's no point. Tidal is slightly less bad, so I am happy to use it for now. It also costs the same. So there's no real skin off my teeth to do it. Other than having to rebuild the artist library and rebuild all of my playlists and stuff, which is going to be a time commitment, but like, yeah, if the bands are making 2 to 3 times as much money every song I listen to, I can sleep a little easier at night. Because I can't always afford to buy every record. You know, I bought the Foxtails record. You know, it's been my number one most listened to thing the last 2 weeks, by a wide margin, and I really like it. And you know, they've got their first printing that they're getting ready. It's not going to ship until July because of the supply chain issues in vinyl. But I was very happy to give them my $20 for that record. I really like it a lot, but not every record. I can't do that with every record, you know? So you do what you can. I think that what Max Collins said is interesting, where he said, like, he said, I would rather people, you know, just straight up steal my music than listen to it on Spotify, because, like, either way, I'm not really making any money, but at least if you steal my music, you're not giving your money to Spotify, who is then going to do heinous shit with it. You know? Tidal's not great, probably. Whoever the person is that owns Tidal, I'm sure, is some VC piece of shit crypto guy or something. I can just tell. But still probably marginally better than Spotify. But that's it. That's my week. I've had a busy, busy week, and I anticipate it being, this next week being even busier, because I'm ramping up job search stuff, starting Monday, and, I'm going out, I'm gonna be doing some shopping with, my friend, on Saturday. We're gonna hit some pawns and some thrifts, looking for stuff, and then on Sunday I'm gonna be playing board games, so I will have, I'm sure, things to report back about from those, amongst other doings and goings on throughout the week. So yeah, look out for that. I should have another video during the week as well about video games that I shot, but I haven't edited yet. So yeah, have a good night.